I'd start just by sort of outlining the shape of what I'm going to talk about today, and then we can go from there. So to start with, I'm going to talk about science, that is what passes for science in a startup environment, what the interesting questions we're asking are, how we approach those, and what some of the answers look like, and what the motivation is. It's not just about making money. The engineering side of that, in that a lot of the science we do is constrained by our ability to build the infrastructure to support it. We do not have 1,000 node clusters, or I think at Yahoo they have a 4,000 node cluster. You know, we have a 10 node cluster. And so a lot of the questions we ask have to be asked in a way that we can actually approach them within those constraints. We also don't have budgets for buying software, so we've built our own real-time time series databases, and we've done some stuff that I think is pretty cool and worth talking about, but that doesn't usually come up in an academic context where you're much more interested in the algorithm and the proof than you are necessarily in the infrastructure required to support it. But in our work, they're tied together. I'll be talking a little bit about philosophy, which is where the data science stuff comes in. I don't really know what data science is, but hopefully we can come to some accommodation by the end of the day. And finally, this part, which will be whenever I address students, I get a lot of shy questions about what is it like to be a computer scientist or a data scientist outside of academia. And so I want to encourage anyone in the room here who has those questions just to ask them. I'm very happy to talk about that. And also, if you want to know anything bizarre about Bitly or about, you know, my adventures meeting Libyan ministers in Paris to try and negotiate around domain names and things, I'm happy to talk about that too. Because what started as an accident of the internet or that's Bitly. It really is an accident of the internet has sort of led us down some bizarre paths to get to where we are now. Before I get into the fun stuff, this is our Bitly data science team. It's important to mention that all the work I'm talking about here is the work of this team and the other engineering folks at Bitly. It's a really good team. But also, I wanted to mention that there are two of us who have a computer science background. We have two people with a physics background, one person with an applied math background, and one person who has just been building search engines for 15 years, has no formal education whatsoever, but totally kicks ass. And so we come to it from a variety of different perspectives, which often leads to battles at the whiteboard around whether Fourier transforms are really the answer to every problem. That's the physicist's point of view, not my point of view. Or whether we can look at something by binning it, or whether, you know, we have to look at it continuously. But that's the team, and that's the perspective. And so the people who, these are the people who actually did all the work. I just get to talk about it. But before I go too far, and do feel free to interrupt with questions or comments, or if you have any great ideas for things we should have tried but haven't tried, I'd love to hear them. I just want to tell you a little bit about Bitly. So how many people here have heard of Bitly before outside of the poster for this talk? That's pretty good. How many people here think Bitly is a Twitter URL shortener? Okay. Most people do. That's our biggest public image problem. This is a smarter crowd, but Bitly takes big, fat things and makes them tiny. So we take URLs like this and make them look like this. As a little bit of trivia, we actually used to use the Jenkins hash function, but had one too many collisions. So now the hash that you get back from Bitly is no longer an actual hash of the URL. Also, if you're logged into Bitly, you will get your own version of that short link, which lets us track the analytics on a per-user basis and in aggregate. So people then take these short links, and they can be on bit.ly or bit.ly.com or j.mp or your own short domain. We power about 20,000 different short domains at this point. And they put them on different social networks, so they end up in places like that or here. We have a bunch of pro clients like the Dalai Lama and Mariah Carey and the New York Times who have their own short domains but are actually sharing Bitly links. And all of these links are in the same namespace. So you could take that O'Reilly link and replace it with bit.ly and it'll still work. You can't go the other way though. So the New York Times was very worried about people sharing pornography with the New York Times link, and so you can only go to bit.ly, not the other way. But this means that Bitly is essentially sitting in the middle of social sharing on the web and through any device where people share links socially. So we get this neat perspective on people sharing things, things jumping from one network to another network, from one person to another person, sort of throughout the internet. And it is one of the few independent data sources on social analytics. Yes?
What's the lifespan of a Bitly URL? Because I thought it lived forever, right? Like
it does. So all links are permanent.
But like recently I clicked on a couple of Bitly links from Twitter, and it said that no such link exists or something.
So that would be if the long URL 404s. The short link will still redirect you to that long URL, but that long URL may not exist.
Also spam? What do you do with spam?
With spam, we issue a 302 redirect instead of a 301 that goes to an interstitial page that just says, stop, there might be badness here. You can click through to the spammy site if you like, and about 8% of people do, which is a metric that, you know, maybe we're not always right when we label something as spammy or people are stupid. Yes.
So the message that I got wasn't like a 404 not found from like New York Times or whatever.
It was from Bitly.
Bitly.
Was that today? Because we had a database hiccup this morning.
I don't know if it was today. I think it was recently.
Yeah.
Maybe my assumptions were wrong. So my assumption isn't wrong.
No, all links are permanent. If you do see a Bitly hiccup, then try reloading a few times. And if it still doesn't work, you should send me an email. There are probably alarms going off somewhere already, but it never hurts. So Bitly links are clicked around the world every day. So this is a picture where we used an open source Google WebGL visualization to plot links by latitude and longitude on an empty globe. So there's actually no map on this globe. It's just 1 hour of clicks on April 31st of last year. And so those spikes occur in places where the geodata builds up. So in areas of the world where we have poorer quality geolocation, and also in very big cities. So you can see sort of the United States and Europe and South America. We get usage in Africa, but less. So I'm not at all a fan of the phrase big data, mostly because it means different things to different people. Sometimes big is too big to fit in your Excel spreadsheet. Sometimes big is too big to fit on one machine. So I'm not going to make any claims about size. I'll just tell you how big it is. It's approximately 80 million new URLs per day, and approximately 300 million clicks on URLs per day, of which we are confident a little bit over 100 million of those are actual human beings actually clicking on links. So we do quite a lot to try and identify bots, crawlers, and other non-human actions. So this leads us to billions of clicks per month, billions of URLs in order, or in total. We actually don't know how many in total, because we still store all of these URLs in a sharded MySQL database, and I'm told that running count on a database that big is a really bad idea. And so while it is backed up and compressed, and all of those links are safe, we don't know exactly how many there are at this point.
So MySQL keeps the count property, actually.
Not the way we have it set up. We used to be able to do that, so we have a number from 3 years ago, and I've been meaning to go back through our logs and count up everything new since then, but I haven't done it yet. But it's on the order of tens of billions of URLs at this point. At least those are the estimates we use in trying to build the next version of that system, which will probably be built on React. So I just wanted to show you examples of what the data actually looks like. And so this is the data we work with every day, just slightly anonymized here. So this is a shortened, or what we call an ENCODE event, where we have a user hash, which is the user's special short version of that link. In this case, it wasn't a logged in user, so it's the same as the global hash. So you would go to bit.ly/ZALAU0, and that would redirect you to this Amazon link. It was created by that IP, though I've X'd out the last two to preserve privacy, at the timestamp, and then the ID is an internal ID. So it's a pretty simple data field. And a decode is a click event, and so we see everything you would normally see in your HTTP access log. So things like the user agents, in this case we know it's Windows NT 6.1 Internet Explorer 9. In the United States, we know it's someone we haven't seen before. They're in the New York time zone. We know they're in New York State. We know which link they clicked on. We know their IP. We have a cookie. We know who created the link they've clicked on. We know their language. Which short domain they've clicked through, where they were referred from, in this case from Facebook, where the URL goes, which is on brainpickings.org, which is a really popular blog with bizarre things, the timestamp, the link creation timestamp, which is here mostly for convenience, the city, and then the latitude and longitude. Yes?
So how do you get the location
information? It's from the IP. It's fairly accurate at the city level, but I really wouldn't trust it too far beyond that.
What's that IP mean exactly? Is it the IP address of the user that actually posted the URL?
No, it's the IP address of the person who clicked on the URL. So we have both of those things. And then we fetch each link and do a fair amount of analysis there. So we have the URL itself, the content at the URL, the distribution of referrers sending traffic, the geographical distribution, the phrases in the page. We do some topic identification. We also give it spam and malware labels. We pull out the interesting content from the page, so we have a content extraction process. And we assign the spoken language labels as well, which I'll get into. And the last piece of data we look at is DNS data. Through one of our partnerships, we have access to some of the .com DNS data. And so we can use that to get a sense of how biased the Bitly data set is, which is pretty interesting. And it also gives us a sense of how big the internet is, which is something I've wanted to know for a long time. And I know that people at Google and Microsoft and maybe Yahoo know the answer, but none of them are telling me. So since we have a pretty internet savvy audience here, how many active .com domains do you think there are? That is .com domains that are queried in a given 24-hour period.
Queries as in somebody resolved.
As in somebody resolved it somewhere in the world.
Does it include subdomains?
No. Just the high-level .coms.
Millions.
There are millions.
I would think hundreds of millions. Stay in a tent.
So the answer is approximately 100 million a day. And so we can see in Bitly data, .coms make up about 80% of our domains that we see. So the internet is actually smaller than I thought it was.
But you see, so you see about 80 million domains a day? Or
.com sees about 100 million domains queried a day. We don't know that. I'm just saying 80% of the domains we see. Uh-huh. I don't actually know how many unique domains we see per day offhand. But that'll be on the order of millions, maybe 10 million. Actually, it would surprise me if it was as many as 10 million.
You get 90 million links, so it's probably
yeah,
skewed.
So it's, and it's very skewed.
So you said it's 80 million new URLs per day?
Yes.
Is it complete URLs, or is it just the root domain?
Right, so long URLs. So many of those long URLs are on the same domain. In fact, it's very skewed.
So you mean it's the actual number of domains is much smaller than 80 million?
Yes, in our data set. I don't know what it is offhand, but definitely much smaller. So what we are essentially doing here is capturing a slice of gossip in one place in a data set that makes it easy to ask questions that you might ask if you were able to capture everybody's gossip. That is, people sharing content with each other. As you might expect, a lot of it is gossip. It is celebrity gossip. It is cute pictures of kittens on the internet. It is news events. It is a lot of restaurant menus and things of local interest. But this lets us ask, you know, what can we learn from a lot of people talking to each other about the things that people care to talk to each other about? And the first thing we learn from this is that people have very different experiences of social networks. So this is a real tweet. This is a girl who thinks that any white person on Twitter is a spam bot. For her, this is true. Looking around this room, it's not true for anyone here. But in a similar way, you know, I saw any Twitter username that belonged to a young buxom woman with numbers at the end, like I would automatically assume it's a spam bot. It's not always the case. So I think this is pretty hilarious. I also have a slide that I didn't put in here, but of this guy on Facebook who gave his goldfish a funeral with lots of Lego guys, which is another example of how that's something I would never see in my social network, which is largely computer scientists and fairly professional. So the first way of looking at this question is just to say, what can we learn by counting the data? And so we can look at, you know, what are the sites people look at? We looked at what devices people use at different times of day. I actually lost a bet on what time of day the iPad gets the most usage. So anyone want to guess?
9 p.m.
Well, yeah, evening is the right answer. I thought it would be during the day, during the work day. But this is a graph just counting up device usage on through the Bitly data, so social web usage, from midnight Monday through Saturday and Sunday at the end, just by hour.
Wait,
so,
you're saying, can you qualify social web usage?
Just Bitly data. So it's all the Bitly clicks. Yes, that's it. You can see here the desktop label means any browser on a computer. We struggled with the language there because they're no longer desktops, but I mean, it makes sense. The phone is largely a smartphone, so iPhones, Android devices. Tablets are mostly iPads, but with Kindle Fire and a few other Android tablets thrown in. Gaming devices are things like Nintendo 3DS, PlayStation, the Wii. I didn't even know that people looked at the web on those devices, but we see a clear peak on gaming platforms on Thursday nights. I'm guessing that's college students.
It's also interesting how during the work week, the gaming and the desktop usage are two separate peaks, but on the weekend they overlap.
Yeah, exactly.
Although this is scaled.
This is scaled. So we see much more traffic from browsers than we do from gaming devices, but we normalize that. So, and this is also normalized by time zone as well.
What's the phone again?
Phones are iPhones and Android devices, so smartphones.
Net accessing the net from those phones.
Yes.
And you would differentiate between an iPhone and an iPad.
Yes.
So they dropped at lunch, is that the...
Yeah, so you can see the lunch break. Mm-hmm. You can sort of get a sense of the coffee break in the afternoon or dinner break. Mm-hmm. So we also looked at device similarity by usage and time. Not by the content or anything else. We saw a few funny things here. So the Kindle is not really like any other device. I, again, didn't realize people looked at Twitter or Facebook or whatever on their Kindles, but they do. And they do so pretty differently. Linux and Windows are very much the same, so geeks really are like the rest of us, I guess. The Mac is different from those two. iPhone and Android are similar. BlackBerry is different from those two as well. Yes?
What's in the numbers?
Oh, so then that's just an arbitrary scale of similarity. I don't think the numbers
lower
are.
Lower is more similar?
So the white is the same, and then a higher number is dissimilarity.
But the similarity is between 0 and 1,
It is. But I don't think it matters. In fact, when we published this, we took the scale off, I think.
Darker,
so darker is different, and white is the same.
But the thing is, like from my perspective, is being between 0 and 1
Yes. So that's just counting. Another problem we're interested in solving is something that requires us to count, but count more cleverly. That is figuring out what spoken languages are in a page. And we have some, so we started out using the same approach that everybody uses to solving this problem, which is doing content-based language analysis. So you build some sort of classifier that says, you know, I know what English looks like, I know what Chinese looks like, I know what French looks like. And that works until you get data that is a tweet that has two characters in Japanese and a bunch of English in it. Really, it's of interest to Japanese speakers, but it would be classified as English because the primary content of the site, twitter.com, is English, and the primary content of the tweet is English. And we get a lot of content that has multiple language sets in it. So what we decided to do instead was to take the raw data we get from the browsers requesting a link and pull the language queries out. So your browser will send a header along with your preferred language distribution based on your operating system languages. That data looks like this in its raw form. It's pretty easy to pick out what's going on here, though. So the top one is Spanish. The second one is saying, give me US English, and if not that, English. And the numbers are just preference weights. And so you can go down and see, you know, British English, et cetera, German. Most browsers do, if they can't find the language they actually want, they then request English. So you have to be a little careful with the English weights. But from this, we can say, okay, for a given link, and this is a Spanish language story about Google Plus. If you go to that URL, you can see the link and all the traffic. These were the breakdowns of the language labels from the browser requests. So most requests were in Spanish, English was second, the third is Catalan, then Russian, French, Portuguese, Italian, etc. It's a pretty popular link. But we're able to do a pretty simple calculation. And in fact, I put the code in here, though my tabs got messed up. This is a little bit of Python code using NumPy that does a very quick some just to figure out what the most popular language is and whether we can trust that based on the entropy of the distribution, and it assigns the label. And so that lets us take pages like this and label them as Japanese, even though a content-based approach would probably call this one English. In fact, Google's Translate API calls it English.
So just to recap, you're calling this Japanese because most of the browser agents of users that click through to see this page had high preference for Japanese.
Right. So we're actually not saying anything about the content itself, but just saying that the content is of interest to people who speak Japanese.
Does that fail in interesting ways?
Yes. It fails in interesting ways on interesting topics. So we've had So again, I said we had to weight English down because by default, a lot of people are browsing in English even if they are looking at something in another language. It also fails on pornography for whatever reason, which tends to get very different traffic patterns than our other content anyway, and may not even have an appropriate language.
Yeah, that's international.
Yeah, but some things are.
I speak a foreign language, but a lot of websites for that language, since it's not in a Roman script, people kind of just type out phonetically what the words would look like, but the words are in a different language. If you read the letters, they're not in any kind of English or Romance language, but they're phonetically.
Right. So that's why this approach works really well for us, because we don't care what the content says at all. It's just what the people looking at it request. So it's based on the operating system language values in the computers of the people looking at the link. It doesn't matter what the content says. It could be a picture of a goldfish, which has, you know, no innate language necessarily.
Well, just to continue on that, then, a lot of people would sometimes go with the traditional English setting on their OS.
Right. So we've had to discount English in this calculation. situation.
So the question, a meme that gets very popular in Japan for some reason, and obviously it gets propagated a lot in the Japanese network, a lot of Japanese people click on it, but it's really a meme in completely, you know, English. Do you actually care that you got it wrong, or is for your purposes it's enough that you know the people in Japan?
So in that case, no, because we're mostly using this to make sure that we expose content to people that's of interest to them. Mm-hmm. And so if we think, and we actually have the other problem more often where there's some crazy Japanese website that's popular in the United States. And so we want to make sure that if we're showing that to you, you're going to think it's funny, mm-hmm. even if you speak English. So far, it hasn't been an issue. No, we started off doing the content-based approach, and now we don't.
Because from my point of view, this page in particular, it gives a checking for one particular person in Japan. Is that usable in your approach?
That this page contains Japanese?
No, it does contain Japanese, but well, also it contains a particular location in Japan.
So, I mean, if we were constraining our analysis to pages of this type, perhaps, but we don't, while we do identify certain characteristics of the content, we haven't yet written a place location extractor. I hope someday to get to that point. Also to look at things like authors of articles and that sort of metadata. Yeah.
Have you been able to track using that how certain names or certain topics will move across the globe, like they'll start out in one country and kind of track the trends as it maybe spreads internationally?
Yes, I don't have a good slide on it, but actually my next topic is looking at internet usage in different countries. In particular, we looked at our traffic through the Arab Spring events, and I'll just show you what this graph looks like. So this is clicks by hour. This graph is not smoothed or cleaned up at all in a bunch of different countries. We can zoom in on Egypt, right. So you can see here, this is where they cut the internet off. It didn't cut it off entirely. We were still seeing hundreds of clicks an hour from military and university machines. But we could actually look at what people in Egypt were clicking on versus people outside of Egypt about Egypt and see how news was traveling from inside the country to outside the country, how videos were getting posted on YouTube and then being looked at inside the country and outside the country. And so one of the ones I thought, this is Tunisia, which I thought is much more interesting because they didn't do anything to interfere with the network connectivity. And if you zoom in here to last January, that's actually where their revolution occurred. And so just from traffic patterns, you can tell that something remarkable is happening here. And so I'm not at all a domain expert in political science, but we've given this data to people who are at George Washington and at NYU, and they're trying to figure out, looking at, you know, what people were looking at during these days and how it spread and whether there's anything interesting there.
What about the earlier peaks? Was there any influences between some of these events and things that are happening later?
I mean, I, again, am reluctant to say that something caused something else, but you can definitely see in this graph these traffic patterns. And that at the bottom there is Libya, which at the time had not gotten, this graph ends last spring, so at the beginning of the summer, had not gotten reconnected to the internet. So yeah, there's definitely patterns. And what is also funny is that at least a couple of these spikes are, one of them was a Celine Dion music video, and then one of them was a Facebook image that we didn't have permission to see, but I sent the URL to someone at Facebook and they said, yeah, it's a political image. Uh-huh.
And like there's a dip and then it just stays low for a while and it starts increasing again. What was happening?
So that's what I find fascinating about this graph. So this is the Tunisia graph where we know that nobody interrupted the network connectivity. people actually spent less time on social networks after the revolution. Like, that's where it happened. The activity continues for a few days, and then it drops off to lower levels than before any of the disruption, and eventually it increased over time, slowly. Have I checked the, I'm sorry? So I don't have that data handy, but it's largely the same stuff that people look at everywhere in the world. So it's YouTube, Facebook, Google, and a few local news sites. And if you're curious, I'm happy to share some of that data. Many of them do. Many of them don't. But the sad fact about this is that I'm an American and I only speak English, and so it is very hard for me to look at a page in Arabic and tell you if it's at all related to something here. So I've given that data to people who have those skills.
But you can look at the, well, hopefully they can look at the composition, right? So it's a simple kind of query will tell you if there are more Facebook links or fewer or more Al Jazeera links before and after the revolution started.
Yes. All right, so moving along, one of the more fun things we can look at is people who click on one site also click on other sites. I'm very interested in the idea of the context around information, and so you could write a story and release it Monday or Wednesday or Friday, and depending on when you release the story, it'll get a very different response online. And I'm sure you heard more about that from Gilad at Social Flow. But we can see what people saw before and after they've looked at a given piece of content and sort of build a network model out of that. So this is a promotion that Playtext did. This is a real website. It's this poor woman was not wearing her bra properly after 30 years of wearing bras, and they taught her how to wear it correctly. But we found that people who looked at this promotion also looked at this page. And this isn't content-based, it's click co-occurrence-based. So this is an Etsy project for a gaming bra. They looked at this, which is a public Facebook image of a tiger who lost her cubs. So the zookeepers didn't want her to be depressed, and they wrapped little piglets in tiger clothes and had her take care of the little piglets. And they looked at these Japanese sandals. So this is another ambiguous language page too, but these are sandals you can wear on the beach that let you leave crazy footprints that are, you know, being looked at by that population. And so we're able to say, you know, given one URL, like what surrounds that? And I'll show you a live demo, but we can do it at an aggregate level. So this is something we did with Scientific American, where we were interested in how people read about science on the internet. So we took a few days of data, tagged it at the category level, using a pretty simple supervised classification process, said, okay, you know, how do people co-read about different scientific topics? And then what else are they reading? So we took all of these sites about science and broke them down into the subdisciplines they fell into, and then we went a step out on that graph and said, what else are people reading? And we found a few funny things, like people who read about math do not read about statistics, and vice versa, but computer science is there on the left, like smack in the middle of those two. People who read about physics read about fashion, though it turns out later that there was an article about clothing made out of milk that was very popular the week that we did this analysis, and so it probably led to that showing up. Health and biology are close together along with food, which makes a lot of sense. Also with disasters, which intuitively didn't make as much sense, but the content there was things like what to do in case of an earthquake, like how much food should you store in your house, and all of that stuff. And then the really funny one is chemistry, where it turns out that people who read chemistry almost exclusively read about chemistry. There are a few connections to anything else, and this is true of two other topic areas. Travel is a bit of an anomaly here, but religion and adult content, we find the same. We didn't put adult content in the published image, but We find that people who look at adult content pretty much only look at adult content. The theory there being that they're using a special computer or a special browser for that purpose. We don't actually see that much adult content, so I don't really know. But religious content is the same. So people who read about religion only read about religion. And same for chemistry. And then have another. Oh, this is hard to see on the screen, so I think I'll skip it and go to the live demo. Yeah, this is one where we built a network of all the top news sites and people who read the different top news sites, and it's hard to make out here, but if people who read the New York Times, a small percentage of them read Al Jazeera, a small percentage of the people who read Fox News read Al Jazeera, nobody who reads the New York Times also reads Fox News, and we saw other relationships like that. And if we're up and running, I can show you a demo. If you've ever done a live demo in front of an audience, you know how that's likely to go. So you'll have to forgive me if this doesn't work. All right. So let's take a domain. Oh, that's not good. Yeah, I don't think this is going to work. We have an API that allows you to see in real time. We call it our Traverse API, so it constructs these graphs. So you can put in a link or a topic or a domain, and it'll say people reading this right now are also reading these other things. But we were doing a server migration right before I turned this presentation on, and one of them crashed, so looks like it didn't come up. So moving on, one of the things we look at is how people look at links over time. We find they tend to follow this pattern where they burst and then decay. We're able to look at this by social network and see that both the type of content and the social network affects what this looks like. But in general, the form is very similar. But we're really interested in being able to identify when a link is normal, that is being shared by social humans, and when a link is abnormal. And so for lower traffic links, we see things like this. These all follow the pattern, but they're much rougher. So that's this, which is an F My Life site in Spanish. That's where people tell sad and unfortunate stories about things that happened to them. This band page and the site that is familiar to anyone who has kids. And then if we look at the abnormal distributions, we find somebody wrapping a bit.ly link around a forum avatar that they used as an analytics service on a website they don't control to see how many times their posts were loaded. This, which is email spam, I'm fairly certain nobody actually wants that. And this, which was actually known to be malware. And so we're pretty interested in being able to automatically, in real time, that is, at any point in the life of a link, be able to say, is this being organically shared or is it not? So again, we started with some very fancy ways of looking at this. At this point, we've built a decision tree model where the features are the country sending traffic, the referrer sending traffic, and then a few binned counts of the clicks. And it allows us to both identify those inorganic things so we can get them out of our systems that expose content to people. That is, because a link is popular in email spam, we should not be recommending it to you. We only want to recommend it to you if it's popular and being shared by real people. And this is something that runs really quickly, so that's important for us. So the next topic is actually taking a lot of these things and combining them into a piece of infrastructure for real-time search. So we've built a search engine over all of the links being shared through bit.ly, that is anything that is being clicked within a 48-hour window of the present will be indexed and searchable. And this is actually a little bit tricky because most search engines assume that you can calculate all of the values you want to take into account at index time, but we actually want to be able to update those values down to the second as the clicks come through. And so we had to build a system that allows us to both calculate values at index time and then calculate values at query time. I'm not sure if there's anyone in here who's interested in search engine infrastructure. So I'll only talk about it very briefly, but it's using a project called Zoe, which is built on top of Solr. It's from LinkedIn. And it uses a very clever hack where you maintain two search indexes, both in memory, one that you write into and one that you read out of. You can swap it every n seconds. And then we have a separate sharded database system running in Redis where we keep all of those keys and values. So we are able, well, I'll just demo it for you. And then if you have any questions, you can ask. Let's hope this one's up and running. That's the wrong. Well, there's a sneak preview of our product that's launching next month. Sorry, they were changing the server over as I was speaking, so stage. Next. All right, that'll work. Please keep in mind that the UI here is only for demo purposes. This is not a product. And this is, in fact, intended to be an API, not really a UI product at all. But we're able to do queries like this. So this is find me every URL being clicked in the last 48 hours through Bitly that contains the term pizza, and then rank order it by current popularity, where popularity is a function of number of times it's being shared, number of times it's being clicked, the different social networks that are driving traffic to it, the decay over time and where we are in that decay. Who is clicking on the link? We've done a project that we call Front Runners, where we try and identify people that go on to click on links that go on to become popular, whether they are in fact causing that popularity or not. And a few other fun things. And what you can see here on the right is our social score, that is the sum, and then with the time decay, what the current rank is of the page. Yes?
Can you search the non-pasture information?
The non...
Non-pasture information, for example, image
index. We don't currently index images, but yes, we have that capability. But one of the things I find... We don't index the images in this UI, but we have a project to find trending images. So, wow, usually that's way more than one link. Here are all of the links that contain the word pizza that are being clicked disproportionately in New York City. We use a similar technique that we use for the language identification for the geo-labeling. And so that's Bon Appetit. Still report. That's nothing. Usually we get some good, like, cheap cheese stuff. This is the same thing for California. So how to make a pizza wrap. Car plows into pizza restaurant on Los Angeles CBS Local. Blogs.sfweekly. And so this was really fun when Herman Cain in particular was running. But we can do the same thing and see, like, okay, how are people reading about Romney in California versus New Jersey? It's better if we find topics that are polarized by location, which is why I like pizza so much. Here's a North Jersey blog. Yes?
What happens if you take trending topics off of Google or Yahoo and run them into this? Is it,
I mean, we would find a similar...
Running, I guess, probably about the same thing.
Yeah. Though I'm not sure, like, you mean Google's trends, the insights product? Because that's their search trends or search insights thing is about 24 hours delayed. So it's not nearly as interesting. But we can do things... Actually, we're in New Brunswick, right? Let's see if we have... Well, we don't have any links about Romney. And we have one particular link for this city. I tried this in Eugene, Oregon once, and it was hilarious. So here are the things getting particular traffic from New Jersey. But there's no actual text query here at all. It's just taking the subset of links with this location label and then reordering those. And we can do the same thing, if anyone here speaks French, for things that are labeled, you know, Google, it is not French. For links that we have labeled to be in the French language, we can say, okay, show us all the French languages, language links being clicked, you know, in Canada.
So with so this is 48 hours, it's like 200 million links. How, do you have an idea of how quickly this how quickly the numbers will drop when you add filters? So language and cities or city and query, how low will you go? Do you have real confidence in the results when you do a combination of city and keyword?
So this is not a comprehensive search engine. Like, we're not trying to be Google and indexing the web. Mm-hmm. If there is content that people are paying attention to right now on the internet that meets all of those filtered criteria, I'm pretty confident it will be here. But often you can come up with a query for which there's nothing.
Mm-hmm. So do you have an idea of how to quantify this confidence? To say, pizza, the results are really good, and we're really sure that this first thing is something that's really popular versus we search for puppy, and, you know, this is what we have, but it's not meaningful.
Let's see. That can't be bad, right?
Puppy can't be bad. No,
I think the question you're asking is, how do we validate the quality of the ranking function? And that's something I've thought quite a bit about, because in order to do it properly, it takes a lot of time. And so we are building a system now that'll get us user feedback, where people are actually looking at results in a product, and we can see which ones they click through, which ones they don't, and hopefully use that. We also have, what we're actually looking at here is our experimental algorithm server, which is why it's got that crazy URL. And so we will take our experimental server and put it next to our production server and get people to do blind tests of which results are better and which ones aren't. And then we do some ad hoc data quality analysis, but again, that's actually a hard thing to solve properly. And if you have ideas, I'd love to hear them.
Can you give a suggestion of things that are happening much more often than you would expect? I'll give an example. There's somebody in Michigan who's building a system to help Chinese get around the firewall. What he built was a steganographic system that superficially was delivering pictures of the cat, but in fact, you know, it had messages.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So the trouble was that he didn't set up an alternate URL, and somebody finally noticed an extraordinary amount of traffic between the same cute kitten over and over again. Decided it had to be suspicious and stomped on and without necessarily knowing what it was.
Oh, that's very interesting. I think that actually ties into my next topic, which is we're trying to look for key phrases that occur in a significant way. So we're interested in this question of what people are paying attention to right now, which is not prediction. I mean, it might be prediction in a contemporaneous way, in that we're using the data that's available now to tell you something you wouldn't have known now without the system. But what we're doing is looking at the actual rate of clicks on phrases versus our expected rate of clicks on phrases, where phrases are, we have a keyword extractor that runs on every page, and then we look to see which keywords are actually significant for that page. But basically, we take the entire raw click stream. We take every raw URL, and then for each key phrase, for each URL, we build up a rate of clicks on that phrase in real time, that is. And we store it in in-memory and now in a Dynamo DB, such that we can go through and say, you know, which phrase is getting a higher rate of clicks than we would expect, and what is the difference. And this is another system that's not available to demo now, but I can show you some screenshots of what it looks like. And again, this is another problem where we started out with a lot of fancy math and eventually ended up with something fairly simple. So we wanted to look at a moving average of the rate of clicks over that phrase. We ended up simplifying it basically to a sum, which is continuous and interpretable and linear and fast. So this means that the number we get out of this function actually means something. It's clicks per second. We tried calling it click hertz, but our business team didn't like that at all. And it's something we can explain to people. And it's also a fairly smooth function. And here we've arbitrarily defined the distribution we're looking at so that we don't see things that go from zero traffic to a tiny amount of traffic as a huge increase. We want them to go from zero traffic to quite a lot of traffic before they'll show up. And this lets us build graphs like this, where each color here is a different link. So there are only two URLs containing the phrase ghostwriter, but we're able to detect when something like that spike at the end happens. So we're basically continuously iterating through our set of key phrases. We track about 500,000 for English, looking at whether the current rate is more than two standard deviations above the expected rate, and if so, we push it out. And here's another example of something that went from zero to quite a lot. This is Jay-Z's baby, Blue Ivy Carter. And here's one that was not bursting at the time we took the screenshot, but Jeremy Lin, that was getting a sustained amount of traffic from a whole bunch of different stories. I can actually try and see if this is alive, but I don't think it is. Nope. That's the fun of working in a startup, I think. Okay. I'm at the end anyway. So the little bit of philosophy that's worth sharing here is that in general for our production systems, it always turns out that the simplest possible approach to solving the problem will get us much further than the more complex one. But we end up having to go through the complex approach to reach the simple approach. And you always have to ask yourself, how do you know when you've won? That is, how do you evaluate whether a project is worth continuing or whether something is actually doing or solving the problem you think you're trying to solve? And in a startup, it's more important to be able to communicate what you're working on effectively because your CEO may decide that it's not interesting and not worth pursuing anymore. But it becomes useful to other people when they can understand it in plain language with simple visualizations. And so we probably spend a third of our time on the fun research stuff, a third of our time on the infrastructure, and a third just trying to communicate to people inside and outside of the company why it is what we're doing is important and how it can help them. And then it's always fun to ask what the crazy questions are. That is, you know, given the data you have, what's the craziest thing you can figure out? And that's where my how big is the internet question came in, but I got excited about it and told you the answer before. How many people on the internet are actually human? We have some good guesses at that. We have a data set for all of the queries to DNS that were wrong. So for domains that don't exist, it's the NXD data, which unlike regular DNS isn't cached, so it gives you a really interesting perspective on humans versus non-humans, how ideas spread, and I'll leave it at that. So thank you.